Hello, everyone. Charles Coleman here, presenting to you The Garden of Fan, a lovely tone poem by composer Sir Arnold Bax, one of our great composers from Great Britain. He is among a class of composers that includes guys like Ralph Vaughan Williams, Sir Edward Elgar, Gustav Holst, Frederick Delius, Frank Bridge, Hubert Parry, and a smattering of others. A very distinctive, great group of composers who I grew up listening to since I was a kid. Keep in mind, these guys were doing their thing while Arnold Schoenberg and his disciples were doing their thing, which granted revolutionized what kind of music would be written after that, but I just simply adore what this group of composers from England did. They may not have reinvented the wheel, but they wrote great music nonetheless, and they all deserve to be heard. In particular, Sir Arnold Bax, born in 1883, died in 1953, just a couple of weeks short of his 70th birthday. He did not necessarily have I don't want to say he had a great life, but he didn't necessarily have a bad life either. You know, he came from an upscale family. He did lose a lot of friends during the two world wars and the Irish uprising, and a lot of his music reflects that. Generally speaking, Garden of Fan as well. He had a passionate love affair with the pianist Harriet Cohen, and he was just one of our great composers that I think is not as well known as he should be. He did fairly well as a composer in his lifetime. He was the master of the king's music up until his death. But after he died, he kind of gotten forgotten until, I would say, around the 80s, when record labels like Lorita and Shandos decided to record as much as they could of his repertoire. He wrote a lot of music. He wrote 7 symphonies. He wrote a mountain of tone poems, 4 piano sonatas, 2 string quartets, several solo piano works, and a variety of chamber music songs and whatnot. And I wanted to present to you my favorite piece, The Garden of Fan, which is based on a story from the Irish Celtic folklore, which was an obsession with Arnold Bax, even though he was British. He alluded to the fact in the score that while the piece is influenced by the story, the Celtic story of Garden of Fan, he kind of clarifies that he doesn't want the music to be a direct interpretation of the story, more of a ambiguous metaphoric sense, because the story is a little vague, and part of the beauty of making a tone poem out of a story is the vagueness of the story itself, which music can add to it, filter in to make the vagueness even more enticing and perhaps more detailed to a certain extent. In The Garden of Fan, we start off seeing the sea. The Garden of Fan is the sea. I guess the word garden is a metaphor in this case. And it starts out with kind of a wide shot of this atmosphere, showing the sea. Very nice woodwind figures. Starting with the flutes, going down to the clarinets, and then going back up and down and up and down while you hear those wonderful brass chords. Here it is. At this point, we meet a group of sailors and the captain sailing through the sea. At first, it's peaceful, but then a great wave carries them up and throws them onto this island where they meet these creatures of, as the tale says, unhuman revelry. Let's hear a little bit of that. The sailors, of course, dance in the unhuman revelry and enjoy the atmosphere. And then the dancing kind of stops and the music seems to imply that they're standing still with these beautiful string chords from the first and second violins and with harp notes that kind of accentuate the harmony. Ding, 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 like that. Well, it doesn't sound that bad. Along with some pulsing lower strings doing pizzicati and arpeggiated figures in the clarinet section. It's a beautiful example of great orchestration. This is one of my favorite sections of the piece. Yeah, it seems as if the creatures have stopped dancing. They seem to stand still and kind of move out of the way as we meet Fand herself. Fand is kind of a sea nymph, if you'd like, enticing humanity to her loving ways and then bringing them to their fate, which happens in this story. But she sings a lovely tune, which is arguably one of the best tunes that Bax has ever written. He knew how to write a good tune, and it's basically a love song which everyone around her is enticed by. Check out this. This is a beautiful section. After that, the music subsides, and then we get back to the unhuman revelry for which the sailors participate in, and then the water rises up and crashes onto the island, drowning the sailors while Fand and her unhuman creatures laugh it away. And at this point, we hear that sea music that the piece started out with, but starting out in a much more dramatic way with the waves crashing onto the island, a completely different atmosphere from how the piece started, but with the same beep, 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 but now in a passionate way. Here's that. Subsequently, the music subsides, and then we hear that sea tune again as the piece started, as we see the Garden of Fand go out of sight. At least that's what it says in the story. Now, it's not much of a story, but as I said before, there's something about the vagueness of it that the music can beautifully add to it, and Bax did it better than anybody. Arnold Bax is probably the greatest tone poem composer from England. By the way, I should mention those excerpts that you were hearing were from a live performance with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra conducted by Leonard Slatkin. And if you want to hear the whole thing, you should check out Richard Adams' channel here on YouTube. I have a link in the description with that performance along with Richard Adams' channel in general. Very charming channel, worth checking out. And there are, as far as I know, 6 commercial recordings of this work. And we're going to talk about all of them, from my least favorite to my most favorite. Starting with my number 6th favorite recording of The Garden of Fan by Arnold Bax, David Lloyd Jones and the Royal Scottish National Orchestra. Now, it's not necessarily a bad recording. It's just, I hate to say boring, but that's what I feel here. And I think it's a combination of the sonics, which are not bad, they're distant. And a lot of great recordings have been recorded with distant microphones. But I think the overall volume is too low for me, and it's just distant, and it feels like the orchestra is not really digging into it, especially when we hear the love song of Fand. It just kind of goes by. And I'm very surprised, because David Lloyd Jones is a great conductor of the pieces of Arnold Bax. He recorded all 7 symphonies, very well done. Most of the other tone poems, especially Tintagel, was one of the greatest recordings of that work. But The Garden of Fan is less than stellar. I mean, it's just, there's like not a lot there. I mean, especially in comparison to the next 5 recordings I'm going to mention. Speaking of which, my 5th favorite recording of The Garden of Fan, Sir John Barbirolli and the Halle Symphony Orchestra. This is a lot more dedicated performance. They definitely dig into it. I just don't agree fully with Barbirolli's interpretation, the way he starts it out. Bee, bada bee, bada bee, bada bee, bada bee, bada bee, bada bee. It's just unusually fast. And I can understand going for it the faster, it has a more, maybe more of a lightness to it. But to me, it just goes by way too fast. And, you know, you can't savor enough of it. It's supposed to be lighthearted, but I think it's a little too much. Although when we get to the love song of Fan, that is definitely a beautiful section of the work. And he definitely goes for it. My number 4 favorite recording of The Garden of Fan by Sir Arnold Bax, Bryden, Thomson, and the Ulster Symphony Orchestra. This was the first recording I ever heard of this work when I was a teenager in the years ago. And it's a generally good recording, a good interpretation. I think sometimes certain instruments are a little bit louder than others. I'm not sure Bryden, Thomson was always careful with which intricate instruments should stick out more than others. It was a huge orchestration with a lot of counter stuff going, though. And it's not always, I don't want to say it's sloppy, but it is not always together in certain crucial spots, especially in Fan's love song when we're at the climax with the cymbal crash. The cymbals are a little bit ahead. Mind you, they're generally together, but because the cymbals are a little ahead, it just kind of deflates the excitement of that moment. Maybe I'm nitpicking, but that's what I felt. Although it's a great enough performance that it got me attracted to this piece, let alone the music of Arnold Bax in general. So it's an overall good performance. The sound is fine. Bryden, Thomson, while he was a great conductor, may not have been as much of a disciplinarian in comparison to the other conductors we were talking about. My number 3 favorite recording of Sir Arnold Bax's The Garden of Fan, Sir Thomas Beecham and the Royal Philharmonic Orchestra. Now, this was done once before. Actually, it was a live performance that he did in the 1920s, which doesn't sound as good. Even though you could hear a good passionate performance from the orchestra, the sound, unfortunately, is not that great. But in this later recording that Beecham did in 1947, the sound is much better. It's in mono, but as David Hurwitz would say, it's good mono. Definitely overall a great performance. And when we get to the love song of Fand, he not only takes his time with it, but he obviously loves it so much that he really digs into it. It's a very passionate performance. I could just imagine seeing Beecham really showing an emotion to it. As far as I know, this piece is the only Bax work that he conducted, or at least certainly that he recorded. He may have conducted other Arnold Bax pieces, but this, as far as we know, the only commercial recording we know of. It is an overall great performance, even in mono. It's a very passionate performance, and I love how they do it. My number two favorite recording of The Garden of Fan by Sir Arnold Bax, Sir Adrian Bolt and the London Philharmonic. This is arguably one of, if not the best, sonic recording of this piece, done in the early 70s, has a nice, even though it's not surround sound, it has a nice grandiose feel, especially when you hear it with headphones. The only problem with it is that they are not together when the unhuman reverie stops, and it seems there's these this trance moment with the beautiful string chords and the ding, ding, ding harp. The harp is going too fast and ends up being about a half beat ahead of the rest of the orchestra. And the reason that doesn't work is because it's inconsistent with the harmony involved. It's ahead of it. Unfortunately, it just makes me cringe every time I hear that spot. But everything else in this recording is really good. I'm surprised that they even bothered to either make another take or find a different take. But that to me is a big mistake. Even though it's subliminal for others, it was a big mistake for me, and I always carry my difficulty of hearing that with that section of the piece. But when we get to Fan's love song, da 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 ba da, beautifully done. Just a really good performance of that. And overall, it is a good recording, despite the section I mentioned with great sound, but even though it has great sound. And now we get to my number one favorite recording of The Garden of Fan by Sir Arnold Bax, Vernon Handley and the BBC Philharmonic. This is, for me, the best recording of this work. The sound, there's a lot of subliminal stuff going on. You could hear a bass drum in piano. You could hear it like in the corner, especially when you hear it with headphones. You could hear moments, no matter how loud the orchestra is, there's where you hear a bass drum going broom, as if to serve the undercurrent. And it just kind of, there's just something about the way it's present that touches me. Kind of like moments in Puccini's La Boheme, when it's the bass drum is like triple pianissimo, but when despite the passion of the orchestra, it has an ominous presence that just adds to the orchestration of it, which it does here in this recording. Everything else is wonderful. The Fan love song, when the waves crashes onto the island and we hear the dee-da-dee-da-da-do. Wow. Overwhelming sound. I think Vernon Handley has more of a feeling of the overall arch of the work than any of the other performances before it. There are lots of more details to go into, but I have to say it's sonically the best, form-wise, awareness of overall form, certain lines that should stick out more than others, and awareness of lots of different colors coming out and making sure who should be pulled back versus who shouldn't. Bax has a lot of indications in this score and other pieces about holding back and pushing forward and whatnot. And I think Vernon Handley does it better than anybody. So those are my picks for the best recordings of Sir Arnold Bax's The Garden of Fan. Bax is, I believe, a generally underrated composer in the classical world, and he should be up there with guys like Liszt and Richard Strauss, especially as far as tone poems are concerned. And he is definitely someone that's worth listening to. I'm glad to see that there have been some great recordings that have come out in the last 20, 30 years, courtesy of Shandos and Lirita and various other labels. This is a great composer, and this is a great piece. It's as simple as that. Thank you. Until next time.